Hello and welcome back guys to Code Key. In this video, we'll talk about recursion analysis. In previous video, we have discussed about analyzing for loops, time complexity of for loops and while loops, this common loops. And then in this video, we'll talk about recursion analysis. We haven't talked about recursion in my channel. So here in this video, no, I'm not going to go in deep about recursion, but just a glimpse of recursion by considering two problems and then analyzing with few examples. If this analysis recursion might have few parts, so this is the first part, I guess, of recursion analysis. So this is the recursion series which I'm continuing. Let's get into it. Recursion analysis. So first of all, let us consider or let us understand what exactly recursion is. For explaining recursion, I would like to just take a very common example where you can see or where you can, you know, understand recursion is for a factorial. Okay. Factorial. This is a program of factorial which I have, you know, written over here. Whenever we, what exactly recursion is like for, it is a method of solving a problem where the solution of the problem depends on the solution of the previous problem. Let us consider that you have to calculate the factorial of 4. Okay. For calculating factorial of 4, what you need? What is the step? You need to know the factorial of previous number. That is 3 in this case. Yes, for calculating the factorial of 3, you need to know the factorial of 2. Yes, similarly, 1 factorial you should know. So this is an example of recursion where we need to know the solution for the previous problem or the smaller problem. Yes, so how do you write that? We are going to use functions in this case. So we are going to return something like return n, the number, times factorial of the previous number. Okay. And then this is going to run until we satisfy the base case or we reach the base case. Recursion should always have a base case. Okay. Recursion should always have a base case. That is the case where it's going to terminate. Okay. So base case is also called as terminating case. Okay. So this is an example of recursion. Very basic example. I guess you understand that. You're going to have some recursive function which is going to get repeated until we satisfy our base condition, that is the termination condition. In our case of factorial, the terminating condition will be like something like 1's factorial or 0's factorial. Okay, if we reach 1, consider that 1's factorial is 1 and stop at that moment. So that is the base condition is required. So this is what exactly recursion is. Okay, recursion is nothing but it is a method of solving a problem where the solution depends on the solution of the smaller instance of that problem. Okay, in this case, the 4 factorial depends upon the 3's factorial and so on and so forth. Now this is an analogy you can understand of recursion, what exactly it is. Consider we have a pile of boxes, okay, and we need to go through it. Okay, we need to go through it. Wait a minute. Yes, we need to go through that boxes, and while the pile of boxes isn't empty, that it should not be empty. We need to grab a box. We need to see if we find a box. If you find a box, add it to the pile of the boxes. Okay, you're going to add that pile to the boxes and go back to the pile. Okay, but if you find the key, then you are done. Okay, so this is an iterative approach. There are two kinds of approaches: iterative approach and recursive approach. Iterative approach, you're going to do the same process, but we have more number of steps. But we have, when we talk about recursive approach, what we do, we go through the items of the boxes. If you find the box, you go through that again. But if we find that what we were looking for, that is key, then you will be done. Okay, so it is same. So which method to use, whether to use iterative approach or recursive approach, totally depends upon the problem. Okay, for some problem, it is better to use iterative approach, and in some cases it is better to use recursive approach. So totally problem dependent. So there are two kinds of approaches. Iterative approach is nothing but using for loops and while loops, and recursive approaches are, you know, when we use this kind of stuff. Okay, when we use functions for that. Okay, so this is what exactly recursion is, and there are two kinds of approaches: iterative approaches and recursion approach. Okay, so there are many problems which you can solve using recursion. Some of the examples are like, for the first which I have taken, that is factorial of a number, then finding the Fibonacci series, what exactly Fibonacci series is, starting with 1. It is the sum of previous two numbers. 2. Sum of previous two numbers. Sum of previous two numbers. You should know the previous number, right? So the solution depends upon the previous numbers. So here also I'm going to use recursion, okay, and so on. Then another is Tower of Hanoi problem, which we'll be discussing in this video. And there is, and that's next is binary search. Okay, again, we'll be discussing it in the video. And there are few sorting algorithms which depends upon recursion. Okay, so these are the two problems which we will be discussing. Okay, so this is Tower of Hanoi problem. Okay, wait, let us first discuss binary search. Okay, binary search. Yes. Okay, so let's move towards Notepad so that you know you should have a proper notes of the things that we are discussing in this video. So now here we are going to discuss what? We are going to discuss binary search. Okay, so binary search. In binary search, okay, wait 1 minute. In binary search, we know, where do we use exactly binary search? We use binary search when we are given an array, okay? When we are given an array and we have to search for a particular element in an array, okay? We have to search for a particular element in an array. So let us consider we have this as array. Okay, this is our array and these are the indices 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. So we have total 10 elements. Okay, total 10 elements and this is our array. Okay, what we have to do is we have to search for an element in an array. Let us say we have to search for 30. Okay, we have to search for 30. Now, what will be the basic method? Or what will be the simplest method, non-efficient method for solving this kind of problem for searching an element? We will go through all the elements in our array using for loop or while loop, okay, till the end of the element. If we found that element, then wow, great, we have found that element. But if we haven't, then we will say no, we haven't. So this is what is called as linear search. Okay, this is what is called as linear search. So in linear search, it takes big O of n time. Okay, because n, that is nothing but the length of the array. Okay, so big O of n time is taken, or time complexity is when we are doing linear search. That is called as linear search, going through each element in an array. But when we talk about binary search, okay, when you talk about binary search, it takes big O of log n time. Big O of log n time. This is how we're going to calculate, or this is how we're going to see how it is going to take log n time. Is that clear? So this is an array that we want to binary search for, but there is just a single condition for, you know, doing binary search, and that is the array should be sorted. Okay, array should be sorted. Okay, and when the array is sorted and when we apply binary search, we get the time complexity of big O of log n. So here in linear search, it is not compulsion of an array to be sorted. Okay, it cannot be sorted either, so it can be unsorted array also. But if it is sorted array and if you want an efficient solution, then you can use binary search because it takes log n complexity, which is less. So binary search uses divide and conquer. Okay, uses divide and conquer. What is divide and conquer? We will again going to have a special session on both binary search as well as divide and conquer. Divide and conquer is way more far from where we are. Okay, it is almost like last topic. So binary search uses divide and conquer. So what exactly is the concept of binary search? What we are given with when we talk about the problem, we are given with an array. Okay, this array is starting from index 0 and ending at n minus 1 index. Okay, so there are total n elements. Okay, and then we are given with a key value. Okay, we are given with a key value, that is the element that we have to search for, the search in the array. Okay, so key is the value to be searched. Now, what exactly this binary search do is, let me draw this array again.
Okay, so this is an array that we have. Again, I'll draw the indices. Write the indices, and that is, this is our array. Okay, so now what does these what do this algorithm do is that it is going to, you know, it is going to divide this particular array into two halves. Okay, it is going to divide this particular array into two halves, and then it is going to search, or it is going to see in which element or in which you know, in which part of the array we have that particular element. Okay, let me explain you. First of all, we are going to divide the array into two halves. That means we are going to need the mid part of the array. Okay, so that we are going to need the mid part of the array. That means we are going to be m. We are going to be doing n by 2, right? We are going to be doing n by 2. So m key value will be n by 2. Now here we are going to have two values, of course, right? Or two cases that we can either take the seal value or we can take the floor value. Okay, seal value or the floor value. We know these concepts. Now here in our case, what will be the mid part of the array? It will be 5, correct? It will be 5. Now we have 10 elements, the length of the array is 10 and 5. 10 by 2 is 5, so we will be having m over here. Now what we are going to do over here is we're going to check whether the key that we are finding, and in this case we are finding 30. Okay, we are finding for 30, right? So we are going to check whether our element is what we were finding in the middle. That means, is arrays m is equal to the key value that we were finding. If it is, then we found the element. But if it is lesser than the element, then we have to look at the left side of the array. And if it is greater, then we're going to look at the right side of the array. So here we're going to have two pointers. Okay, you're going to have two pointers, that is left and right. Okay, so what are the conditions that I have told you? When we are going to consider, or how our algorithm goes, is you're going to find the value of m. That can be a floor value as well as, or can be a seal value, you can take either. And if value of key is equal to the value of which the key is equal to the middle value, then do what? Then we found the element, and we're going to return the position of the element, that is m. Then we're going to say, like, if key is less than the value of value at the middle, then what we're going to do, we are going to tell it to move recursively search for left part, right? Go and see for search. Do the same process for left part also. And if key is greater than value of m, then we're going to say recursively search for left part and right part. So these are the three statements that is important, right? What we have to do, we have to see whether the element which we are searching is it in the middle, or is it in the right, or is it in the left. Okay, if it is in the right part, then we do the same process, find the middle part, get the middle part and see whether it is again less or, you know, what, less or more. Okay, now let us devise an algorithm for this. Okay, let us write an algorithm for binary searching two elements. Okay, so now what we have is, we have algorithm for binary searching. So what we are given with, an array. Okay, we are given with the left part of the array and the right part of the array, that means starting index and the ending index of the array, and we are given with the key that we have to find. Okay, and the key that we have to find. Okay, you need to understand that we can do this process using iterative method also. Okay, now what we have to find, first of all, we have to find what m is. What is m? M is left plus right upon 2, correct? Left plus right upon 2, we're going to divide the particular left and right part, because you know when we found that it is less, the right part is going to go over here. The right part, the right part will be over here. Yes, so right part is updated to m minus 1, the index previous to the middle element. If you are able to understand what I mean, I'll explain you now over here. See, so we have this m, okay, value of m. Now if the first condition, if value of key is equals to the array at the middle, if it is, then I tell you to return the index of the element. Else if key, the second condition, if key is less than, now what, the element at the middle, then we have to recursively search for the right left part. Now for left part, that means what, we're going to return calling binary search function, and here we are going to give the array. The left part will be the left part, but the right part is going to be m minus 1 and the key that we are searching for. If you are able to understand what I mean, the right part is going to change to m minus 1. The left part is going to be the left part because we're going to search for this particular part of the array. Yes, and the right part is going to be m minus 1. Similarly, else that key is greater than, then return binary searching a. Now the left part is going to change. Now over in this case, what will happen? In this case, what will happen? We're going to move this left part over here. That is, this will be left, which will be m plus 1. When we are talking about what? We are talking about, when we are talking about searching the, recursively searching for right part. So left part will be m plus 1. Right part will be the right part. And key A will be key, because key is the element that we are searching. Right? So this is an algorithm. But I think in previous lecture only I have told you, or in in this lecture, before starting, I told you that we must have a base condition, that what if we are not getting that element, we recursively search for that particular element, but what if we don't found it? So what will be the condition that we, what will be the condition when we can say that we have not found that particular element? So that condition will be when these right part and left part cross each other. Okay, when the right part and left part cross each other, that means what, we need to have a condition such that if left part becomes greater than right part, which must not happen if we found the element, then we are going to return, we're going to return minus 1. Okay, minus 1 will be better, right? That is, this is the base condition, and we didn't found that element we are searching for. Okay, so this is the very basic and very important algorithm when we talk about recursion. Okay, because what we are doing over here is we are just searching for an element by dividing the array into two halves and then recursively searching for that part that we have divided. Okay, if I am, you know, clear with it. Now here what we have, n is nothing but length of the array, but length of array changes every time. Yes, so for that we're going to use right minus left plus 1. So this is the length of array, and for, you know, sake of calculating the complexity, we consider that n is equal to 2 to the power k, some constant. Okay, for just now calculation, I'll explain you why we need to assume that, you know, n is equals to 2 power k, because it can be maximum. In worst case, we always, worst case or upper bound, we always calculate complexity for upper bound, right? So the time function for this, what can be, time function can be it can be one if the value of n is one. That means we just need to go for one step. That means if we have the length of array is one, then that is the element which we are searching for, or it is not present in the array. But if it is not, but if it is present, or we are going through the algorithm, then 1 plus t 1 by 2, n by 2, t of n by 2, if I'm able to clear you, when n is greater than or equals to 2. So this is the time function that we got when we, you know, go through this algorithm. Okay, 1 plus, the 1 is nothing but for, you know, checking whether the element that we have found is that or not. And if not, then go through this part, right? Now let us find the complexity of this algorithm. So now for finding the complexity of these kind of algorithm, that is recursive algorithms, we have few methods. And those methods are like repetitive substitution. Then we have recursion tree method, and then we have master theorem. We also have one more, that is method of induction, but I'm not going to discuss that because I'm not good at it. Okay, so I'm not going to discuss this, but I'm going to discuss these three, that is repetitive substitution, recursion tree method, and master theorem. So now in this video, for two problems that we're going to solve, that is Tower of NoE and binary search, we're going to use a repetitive substitution method. Okay, so now for repetitive substitution, what we have is, we have t of n is equals to 1 plus t 1 by 2, t of n by 2, right? Now, okay, let me go in the next line too, so that you know. So what we have t of n is having two parts, one when n is equals to 1, and 1 plus t of n by 2 when n is greater than or equal to 2. Okay, now using repetitive substitution, what we have t of n is 1 plus t of n by 2. Okay, we will consider this because here is where we have recursive function, no? Okay, so now this is equal to what? This is equals to 1 plus t of n by 4. What I have done over here, I have calculated the value of t n by 2. That means t of n by 2 is nothing but 1 plus t of n by 2 by 2. Okay, instead of n I have written n by 2. That means 1 plus t of n by 4, correct? 1 plus t of n by 4, and same that I have written over here. Okay, similarly, if I have to calculate for the value of n by 4, then that will be 1 plus t of n by 8, correct? Similarly, if I have to find the value of t of n by 8, that will be 1 plus t of n by 16, correct? And if you are, you know, experienced enough in mathematics a bit, you will see a pattern over here, that what we have 4 plus t of n by 16, that is 4 plus t of n by 2 to the power 4, which can be written as k plus. Now here we are, you know, going like arbitrary, or for any value of t, k n upon 2 to the power k. Is that correct? Because the next will be what? 5 plus t n by 2 to the power 5, that is 32 n. Yes. Now, but what we have considered in our example, or in this case, that n can be 2 to the power k, right? N can be 2 to the power k. That means the value of k can be log n, correct? The value of k can be log n. So putting the value of k as log n, and putting the value of ns2 to the power k, right? This got cancelled and we have log of n plus t of 1, and t of 1 is 1 in our case. When n key value is 1, we have the value of t of n as 1. So the t of 1 is 1, and what we got is we got log n plus 1. So the complexity, the time complexity for, you know, the complexity, this is time function t of n, but the complexity of, or the time complexity for the algorithm is big O of log n. If I am able to explain you properly, do like, share. Okay, so this is what exactly algorithm for binary search is. What we have done, we have divided the particular problem into two halves. Then we have conquered by, you know, by searching for the element in the proper half. Okay, we have left these part. We do not care about this part, right? We have totally ignored, because we know that the element is not present over here. That is why we need that the array should be what? Sorted. Yes? And then go through this particular algorithm, okay? 2 to 3 times, try to dry run it by keeping the values in this particular algorithm, okay? And then you will be able to understand what exactly this algorithm is and how we use recursion properly. Okay, and by next example, that is Tower of NO, you will be able to understand this particular algorithm or this particular method of solving the algorithm more properly. Okay, so we have two methods for implementing any type of algorithm: iterative method and recursive method. The recursive method is like this, somewhat like this, and analysis, how do we do analysis, is like this. So I'm going to discuss these three methods in our videos. You can go through the links down below if you want to know how we apply method of induction in this particular example also. Okay, so you can go through the notes of, you can go through this PDF also. The link is in the description, or the PDF is in the description. Okay, go through it. Now let us move to Tower of Hanoi. Okay,
now let us move towards the next problem, and that is Tower of Hanoi, right? So consider this as a problem. That is, yes, this is a problem. That is Tower of Hanoi. So what is this problem is, I'll explain you. The statement is like, we are going to have three towers, also called as pegs. Okay. And you're going to have more than one ring. Okay. We can have two, we can have three, we cannot have one. The rings should be more than one. Okay. And these rings are of different sizes and are start upon in ascending order. That means smaller one sits over the larger one. Okay, simple. Now what we have to do is, we have to move this tower to the next, we have to move all these, you know, rings to different tower. Okay, so our mission is to move all the disks of one tower to the another without violating the sequence. That means the lower one should be at the lower one should be or the smaller one should be over the larger one, and only you can remove the top disk. Okay, and only one disk can be moved at a time. So these are the rules. So what are minimum number of steps that you can do, okay, for these? Okay, so again, I'll repeat the rules, that the lower one or the upper one should move first. Okay, only the top disk can be removed. Only the disk can be moved among the towers at any given time. Okay, only one disk can be removed, and there can be no, means the sequence must not change. That means larger one should be under smaller one. Now let us consider, or let us solve this first. Okay, what we have, the zero step is this. Okay, the next step can be like moving the upper one. I'll just move you, go through it. Okay, we are not violating the rules, we are just moving one, you know, disk at a time, and lower one or the bigger one is always under the smaller one. Okay, so we, for this, when we have n equals to 3, okay, when we have three disks and three pegs, okay, these are called as pegs, we have minimum seven steps are required. Okay, one thing that you need to observe, that we have three blades and here we required 7 steps. Okay, so consider we have n plates and the minimum number of steps that will be required to solve the puzzle will be 2 to the power n minus 1. Okay, so 2 to the power n minus 1 steps will be required for, you know, for solving this kind of puzzles. Okay, now let us find the complexity of these algorithm. Okay, and let's use this slide only. What you can see over here is I have removed one disk. Okay, I have removed one disk so that, you know, the problem will be simple if we consider we have only one or two disks. Let us consider we have two disks. Okay, so if we have one disk, then we'll directly move to the destination, right? No issues. But when we have two disks, what to do? You're going to move the upper one first, okay, the lower one to the extra peg. Okay, I call it source, destination, and extra. So I'll move this upper one to the extra peg, and then this the bigger one to the destination, and then this again to over destination. So what we are doing is we are doing n minus one disk, that is the smaller disk from source to extra, from source to extra, and then we are moving the nth disk to destination, from source to destination, and then we are moving that extra, the disk that we which we have kept at extra, to the destination, and by that will be completing. Now let us write the algorithm. Okay, let us write the algorithm for this. So let us move towards a notebook only first. Now here we are discussing Tower of Canoeing. Okay, Tower of Canoeing. What we have three things. We have source. We should know the source. We should know destination, and we should know the extra peg. Yes, and n, that is number of disks. So these are all the things that will be given to you. Okay, so we're going to make a function, something like algo Hanoi, algo of Hanoi. Okay, and what we are having number of disks. We are having the source disk. We are having the destination disk. Here, just writing the, you know, process, and they'll be having the extra disk. Okay, now if we are having just one disk, okay, you're not going to have any base case. If you do understand what I mean, that you're not going to have any base case in this example. Okay, our program is just going to halt when we fulfill our, you know, job, that to move from source to destination. So we're not going to have any kind of base case. Now we can halt the program once if we have only one, you know, one disk. Just move the disk from source to destination, right? Just move the disk from source to destination if we have only one disk. But if we have disks more than one, that is else, then we have to do three steps. What are those steps? Are move n minus one the disk from source to extra, and these all three things. So we're going to call the Hanoi function recursively, such that we have to move the n minus oneth disk from source, and our destination will be extra, right? And extra will be destination. That is step one. Okay. Now, after doing this, we have to move the disk from source to destination. That is our step two. And then again, we're going to hold the Hanoi function. We have to move the n minus 1 disk from extra to where is the destination? To destination. And the extra will be source. This is the step 3. Correct. So these are 3 steps. Now let us analyze this function. Okay, let us analyze this. Let's see what we have. Here we have n disks, and the basic operation is to move from one peg to another. So there is no best case or there is no worst case. We just have to do our job. Okay. So now the recursive function for this can be like t of n is equals to what? T of n is t of n minus 1 plus 1 plus t of n minus 1. If you are able to understand what I mean, t of n minus 1, 1, t of n minus 1. In one iteration, first it is going to run t of n minus 1 time, this statement is just going to run 1 time, and then this statement is going to run n minus 1 in one iteration. Okay, that means this is 2 of t n minus 1 plus 1. Okay, so now this is our function, that is t of n is equals to 2 t n minus 1 plus 1. What you can see, what we have is a recursive function, and again we can use what? We can use repeated substitution. I'll tell you the next methods, that is master theorem and recursion tree method, I'll be explaining in the next video. So, and also I'll be explaining substitution, but this is just to, you know, give you a glimpse of how we calculate basic. Okay, you can also call repeated substitution as, you know, backward substitution. Backward substitution. Now let us solve this. What we have? We have t of n is 2 times t of n minus 1 plus 1. We can calculate t of n minus 1. That will be, or what exactly t of n minus 1 is? T of n minus 1 is 1 plus 2 times t of n minus 2, right? Okay, I'll write it something like, you know, t of n minus 1 is t of, or 1 plus t of 1 plus 2 times t of n minus 2. Okay. Now, so this can be written as 1 plus this one, 2 plus 4 t times, oh sorry, yes, 4 times t n minus 2. Now this t n minus 2 can be written as 1 plus 2 times t n minus 3. This can be written as 1 plus 2 plus 4 plus 8 times t of n minus 3. Again, this t of n minus 3 can be written as 1 plus, you know, okay, we will just stop over here. You can understand what I mean to say. What you can see over here is 1 plus 2 plus 2 to the power 2 plus 2 to the power 3 t times n minus 3. What you can see, we see a pattern over here. What is that pattern? That pattern is, like, if we go on and on like this, if we go on and on like this, we're going to get 1 plus 2 plus 2 power 2 plus 2 power 3, or yes, plus 2 power n minus 1, yes, t of 1. It's going to go till 1, right? And we know what t of 1 is. It is 1. So what we have as a time function, we have as time function is 1 plus 2 plus 2 power 2 plus 2 power 3 plus dot plus 2 power n minus 1. What is this? It is geometric progression. It's geometric progression. And by that, the sum of GP is 2 power n minus 1 upon 2 minus 1. Right? So what we have t of n is 2 power n minus 1. Okay? So the time function for this tower of Hanoi is 2 power n. And the time complexity is O big O of 2 power n. So this was analyzing. Now, normally what we have is we have two type of recursions, okay, or two type of recursive functions. You know, two type of recursive functions, something like t of n, okay, t of n can be something like alpha t of n minus 1 or n minus beta, that can be any number plus some function, okay, or it can be like t of n is alpha t of n upon beta, okay, plus f of n. So this can be recursive functions. It cannot be times, I guess. Okay, if it is, I'll let you know, or I'll correct myself in the next video. But for now, you can understand like the recursive function are generally of these form: 2 of t power n minus beta and 2 times, or sorry, alpha times t into n upon beta. And there must be some terminating conditions: t of gamma, something like c, and t of gamma, which is equal to c. This can be a terminating, this should be a terminating condition, okay? This is necessary. Let us move towards our presentation if there is anything left. So this is it, and the complexity is big O of 2 power n, correct? For your information, I can tell you like we are repeating one step, that is moving the function, moving the disk from source to destination, moving the disk from source to destination. If it is possible in the next video, I'll be correcting myself, or I'll be telling you one more algorithm where we are just going to remove the step by considering not starting from n equals to 1 but starting from 0, okay, n equals to 0 by that. Or you can think of it, okay, think of it, or think of the algorithm which is more efficient than this if it is possible, okay, because we are repeating one step, that is this, that should be avoided, okay. So we have done binary search. And this is what I was talking about. Generally, the recursive functions are of the form these, okay? And these recursive, these initial conditions are must. In the next video, we'll be analyzing algorithms, okay? We'll be taking few examples of recursive functions and we'll be analyzing it using three methods, that is recursion tree method, by modern master theorem, and by repetitive substitution, okay? So these are the three methods that we'll be, you know, focusing on. And what we have next, yes, this is the master theorem that we'll be talking about in the next video, okay? So thanks for watching. You can check out the previous video from here. Do like, share and subscribe, and I would like to tell you that the notes for the first lecture are uploaded in the description box. You can check that out. All the references that I have used in this video are also linked in the description box, so do check that out. Do subscribe also, okay, so that you should be you get the notification of the next video. So in next video we'll be discussing analysis of recursion, and we'll be going through few time functions, okay? So this is it. Thank you.